Sure. I'm a nuclear medicine physician. I was trained in France. I joined the UCLA Theranostic Division 5 years ago, and now I'm leading the clinical research program of the Theranostics Division. So Theranostics now, the research is a lot about PSMA. There are other targets as well, but we work a lot on PSMA-targeted Theranostics in the past 5 years. Precision medicine is a term that encompasses many, many different things, in fact. It can go from imaging-based precision medicine, but you have many others with the genetic, with the some blood tests, or you can put, or AI, you can put any parameters for precision. I'm going to talk only about imaging-based precision medicine, and more even specifically, PET imaging-based precision medicine. That's what I do, because you can also use other imaging techniques to do other types of precision medicine. So let's talk about PET imaging in prostate cancer and how it can help prostate cancer patients and prostate cancer doctors. So here it's not about PETs, it's more about treatments. So Theranostics, you know, is a combination of imaging and therapy aiming for the same molecular target, which is here PSMA. These studies you're referring to are the reports of PSMA targeted molecular radiotherapy of our cohort of patients treated here at UCLA. It was prospective studies. We investigated 2 level of radioactivity injected of lutetium PSMA. One was 6 gigabecquerel, one was 7.4 gigabecquerel. We followed the patients for a couple of years. And then here in these studies, we report safety and efficacy in these 2 cohorts. So it's not really about PET imaging. Here it's more about treatment targeting PSMA. Just briefly, if I have to talk about the results of this study at the end, we showed that there was no real significant difference between 6 and 7.4 gigabecquerel. It was safe. The side effects and the toxicity profile was good and, let's say, manageable with standard of care, good medical oncology therapies. And it showed very good anti-tumor effect as well. It seems that the more you see a PSA response, the more it is correlated with outcome survival at the end. And there are studies that are much more bigger, such as the VISION trial, that show similar results with good anti-tumor effects and even a good effect on the outcome of the patient, overall survival and radiographic progression survival. So at the end, lutetium PSMA is now a very more than a promising treatment. It starts to be in the landscape, more and more established. I'm sure that in the next years, it will become standard of care for this patient population, which is post-chemotherapy mCRPC patients. And we see that more and more. It has a good safety profile, especially when you compare it to chemotherapy, and it has a good anti-tumor efficacy, especially if you select better the patients. And this can be a transition to more precision medicine using imaging. The way we should select patient, or how, if we should do or not selection based on PSMA PET imaging for this treatment, this is where we can talk a little bit of more precision medicine. Yes, let's have an overview of the current practice as of now. Usually we say patient is eligible to receive PSMA targeted molecular therapy if the PSMA PET is positive and has some kind of broad criteria. So in VISION, it was uptake of PSMA PET, the PSMA PET signal above the liver, and no lesion that you could see on the CT without PSMA uptake or uptake below the liver. In the Australian trials, they use a dual tracer approach, including FDG PET, which allows to detect more PSMA negative lesions. FDG PET is the glycolytic PET tracer. So it would show highly glycolytic, mostly aggressive lesions. Then you can combine that maybe CT or MRI would not have shown. And you can combine it with PSMA PET and you can see if it match. If you have, again, the same thing, lesions PSMA negative that you see on a VG PET, they were excluded as well. So at the end, in Vision, they define PSMA negative lesions using conventional imaging. And in the therapy trial or the Australian trial, they define PSMA negative lesions using conventional imaging and also FDG PETs. So they excluded more patients. So that's one thing. It's how you define these criteria to select patients for the therapy. There are multiple layers of understanding here. Because of course, the better you select the patient with very high uptake, low tumor volume, no FDG lesions, no PSMA negative lesions, they will probably respond better than the others. So you can have better response rates. But it doesn't answer the question of what you do with the others and should we treat them or not, because you can still have a pretty good effect even in patients that are considered either PSMA negative by imaging, PSMA negative by imaging. So all these thresholds, the way you play with it, it will impact your survival outcomes, but it doesn't really, there is no yet good treatment algorithm for defining this. So I think this will come. The more and more patients are being treated with lutetium PSMA therapy, and the more we'll be able to analyze the imaging baseline characteristics of these patients and try to identify cohorts of very good responders, very poor responders. And maybe in the future, we will do prospective trials using the PSMA PET patterns and the PSMA PET different criteria to do different types of therapy and see if there is really prospectively a difference between these patients. But as of now, this is a bit early. And the data, mature data will come in the future. Yes, so all these technologies are still new. So the Vision trial is very good. It was made for registration purposes and approval of the FDA. It's robust data, it's very valuable data. There are other data, for example, in Cornell, in New York, they treated some patients even with PSMA negative scans. So there is a little bit of small cohorts reported with PSMA negative score initially, treated with PSMA targeted therapy, and there is a little bit of outcome data there. As expected, and let's say, hopefully, the outcome of this patient is worse than the one that were highly positive, which shows that, of course, the more uptake you have on PSMA PET scan, the less number of PSMA negative lesion, the better the response to the therapy, to the PSMA targeted therapy, the better the response will be. So that goes in line. Now, I think, again, mature data will come little by little, the more we do these studies. It is important also, it would be important also to have some data in PSMA negative patients. And one other improvement we could do in that space is to have automatic tools. PET-CT is a whole body imaging modality. And usually when we say SUV, we talk about SUV max. So we will look at the highest uptake in one of the lesions among all the lesions. And you can have very high heterogeneity of the disease with other lesions with low uptake, some lesions with high uptake. And if you take just the SUV max, you're really not capturing the whole body disease burden. And why is that? It's because when you do it slice by slice, it takes time for the imaging reader to do all these assessments. And if you have to define what is disease or not on the whole body level in very heavily metastasized patient, it takes a lot of time. So automatic tools where you would do one click, you will have the whole body tumor segmented that will give you the volume of the PSMA expressing disease, that will give you the level of PSMA expression with SUV mean in the whole body. So the average SUV and not only the max. that would give you maybe some even further definition of the amount of bone tumor volume, the amount of lymph node tumor volume. And with all these parameters on the one-click method, this will help a lot to implement and use PSMA PET parameters to define the prognostic of patient and maybe even to define some treatment algorithms based on that. These tools are being developed by multiple either industry vendors or academic researchers. They are not yet ready for prime time. I hope it will come soon, because that's the only way really to use the PSMA PET information is these tools widely available and implemented. No, I would love to be invited again, because there will be many updates. This is a very dynamic field, a very dynamic topic. And let's say every 3 to 6 months, we have new reports. We learn every day. So I'm sure I have new things to say in a very short time.